Throughout Civ 6 history, Domination has been a staple for the Civilization 6 series, and I'm not talking about BDSM. Conquering and subjugating populations is entirely possible and even encouraged, as you can steal native yields, research, and artifacts after donning your British monocle and taking a trip down to India. In this Civ 6 or Civilization 6 guide/tips video, I'm going to be showing you 5 tips for a domination victory that you don't know about in Civilization 6. Let's get started. Eurekas and inspirations are an integral mechanic of Civ 6, and like Black Friday sales, they give you an immense discount on tech cost. But unlike Black Friday, you don't have people fighting and declaring blood feuds against each other for 50% off some old Navy jeans. This mechanic doesn't seem to be as mainstream as it should, as in the context of domination, getting everything faster means you will have more time with your shiny new swords and horses before the enemy can mount a response. Whether it be crossbows and walls early, or getting a cavalry army in the late game that one-shots your 4-promotion bombard, every little bit of time counts, as the difference between 1 to 2 turns is the difference of the AI getting walls or some other advanced unit/defense that stops your advance in its tracks. And getting everything Eureka'd theoretically would give you 30% off. Which means, for every 10 techs you get, if you Eureka all of them, you've saved the equivalent of 3 technologies, which will allow you to get everything maybe 20 to 30 turns faster than usual when going for something like a swordsman beeline or really any unit beeline at this stage. This method is just switching off techs you're going to Eureka in a couple turns and going to work on something else in the meantime. For example, if you know you're going to build an iron mine and you have pretty much most of ironworking researched and a Eureka would give you the technology, just go ahead and start research on battering rams or some other technology you need, as you will save a lot of science that way. While you do need to finish some techs as soon as possible, like ones with strategic resources like bronze working so you can find and settle the iron tile, or maybe even the unit you're beelining if you're already kind of behind technologically, but for the most part, especially with some techs you don't need right away, go ahead and research something else, or research another civic, go learn how to fish in 1800 AD, because I mean, come on, you're about to launch into space and you don't even know what stars are, just get astrology. All in all, it is better to wait for Eurekas, because unlike the AI who rarely do this, using this method means you'll actually need less science per turn by about 20 to 30%, and you would still be ahead in technologies and civics, even on deity. Now, no one I find on the internet talks about the actual army ratio you'd need and what domination strat you should be using per era. And the reason to that is because it honestly depends. Depending on who your enemy is and who your own civ is that you're playing, what units you have, your promotions, what your strengths lie in and what the enemy is countering, as well as any defensive buildings they have. For example, if they hired an encampment that acts like Gandalf from Lord of the Rings on the only mountain pass, screaming "You shall not pass," then you really can't do anything and you need either planes or a massive tech lead to break that defense. But I'll split up the overall ideal army composition depending on era, between the ancient, classical, medieval, renaissance/industrial, and modern era plus. Now, the best army to wage war in the ancient era is... You really think you're doing anything in the ancient era? Get out of here. Now, the classical era requires 3 swordsmen, 1 battering ram, and 3 to 6 archers should be enough at this stage. You really want archers to take out enemy units because they're that strong, while your swordsmen take out walls, like in the Trojan War with the battering ram, because they do a lot against ancient era walls. The medieval era, you want 3 men-at-arms, 1 siege tower, maybe 2 trebuchets, and 4 to 6 crossbows. You essentially upgrade your melee and ranged units and build a couple trebuchets. Knights are fine in the medieval era if you have trebuchets, but the problem is, like catapults, they're about as strong as a wet paper towel, and one decent fart and the whole structure's just gonna fall over, and then you'd have no way to actually take out cities because knights can't make use of battering rams, so the first strat with man-at-arms and a siege tower is a lot more consistent, but if you have something like a great general and you can move and attack with your trebuchets in one turn and take out the walls almost immediately, then the second strategy is also fine. For the Renaissance slash industrial era, you want 4-5 cuirassiers slash musketmen, 4-6 field cannons, and 3 bombards. This era is really where siege units go through their anime training arc, as they are now the only way you'll be able to take out walls, since there's no equivalent of a siege tower for Renaissance era walls and up. Until about planes, which rain death from the skies, but we'll get into that. Depending on how you promoted your units, you either keep the melee or build a new cavalry-focused army, start hopping on that horse and start riding like Catherine of Russia, and build some cuirassiers as running around pillaging everything while your bombards destroy walls is the best strategy, with field cannons being cannon fodder, kill me, or to take out enemy units. Now, for the modern era, like Negan in The Walking Dead, planes come midway through and start swinging their massive package around after taking control. Do you have oil? Build more planes. Do you need to build something in a city? Build more planes. Can you not build any more planes? Build another aerodrome and build more planes, and maybe a couple melee units. It doesn't help that the AI is like a preschooler in a college-level course, as the AI is completely outclassed and won't even think about building any counters to your planes, aside from maybe a fighter or an anti-air gun here or there, which is why you keep around tanks, mechanized infantry, helicopters, essentially anything that goes very fast, as after your bombers are finished bombarding enemy cities to dust, you'll be able to use your units to bypass zone of control, take out cities, and take out any straggling units, literally blitzkrieg, and use it to wipe out the remaining few capitals. Now, despite the fact that 85% of you currently watching aren't subscribed, I don't want that number to go down too low. I just want you guys to help me get it to about 69% for the memes, so if you do enjoy, leave a like and subscribe to help me achieve my goals. Money in Civilization VI is like a lame horse, treated like a second-class citizen, and pretty much just ignored. But for Domination, money might be the most important yield behind science and culture for a number of reasons. The most important part is the fact that production won't be as important, because you're going to want to keep your starting ancient era army and just upgrading your troops with money so that you can get the most advanced units as fast as possible, and so you can keep all the upgrades you've earned. And the way to do that is, you guessed it, money. If you do have to replace the well-promoted units because of your mistakes, looking at you, Varus, then just restart, because you've already lost at this point. AI is always going to have more units than you. You really need a better quality army, kind of like Prussia, in order for you to actually win a domination victory. You could obviously still make a comeback, but every unit you lose is having production, time, and money wasted until you can build a unit and get it just as promoted and strong as your lost unit. This is a lot more catastrophic than it seems, so don't lose any units, but that's not the only thing money can get you. Outright buying units for cores and armies, as well as paying for maintenance in the late game, is very important. Not to mention, while building commercial hubs for money, you'll get traders, which help your other yields, and will give you diplomatic visibility for more combat strength that will help you take out enemies a little bit easier. Money also helps you catch up in yields while preparing for domination in the early game, as you can buy buildings like libraries and barracks, as well as patronaging key great generals that you might need. Finally, if your war efforts go south faster than the Germans after Stalingrad, you can pay the AI money to make peace, which can be helpful in allowing you to regroup and repush if necessary. Money can essentially do and protect you from everything, kind of like our real world, Jeffrey Epstein. And like the real world, money is the most versatile tool in Civilization VI, and while it might not completely change your game in any one victory type, domination included, you will still make use of it the most in a domination victory. Now, for the tip that was on the thumbnail that was really meant to clickbait everyone to get more views, not really, because you should really never declare war ever unless you do this, which is have an advantage. Now, what that means is multiple things, but I mean, at the end of the day, you know that if your enemy has field cannons and you're there with your swords and arrows, you should probably not declare war on them because it's not going to turn out too well for you. But that isn't exactly what I mean. Even if you have the same technology and the same amount of units and the same unit composition, you still don't want to declare war, as the AI can spam out units faster than you due to their bonuses in gold and production, faster than you can say I surrender. If you're fighting swords for swords with the AI, for example, they get a combat strength on the higher difficulties, meaning you'll always be at a disadvantage. And if the AI has a unique unit like the Indian Varu or the Roman Legion, you want to avoid that civ at all costs. You will lose unless you get extremely lucky, and even then it won't be worth it. The AI spams out their unique units so fast in the game, they're just programmed to, and some are greater than others. So if you go up against India, for example, you'll get double penetrated by Varu so fast, you'll think you got a roll on blacked. Some advantages you do want to go for are, number one, a stronger military. Check out the ribbon on the top of the screen or unlock it in the interface settings. If you have a much larger military than they do, you should probably go to war with them. The other one is building shiny new units, which, you know, obviously if you have knights and they have swordsmen, you will almost always win that war. Number three is you want a unique skill set for domination so strong and broken that the creator of said civ was probably smoking the most succulent of marijuana plants when they created this monstrosity. Babylon. It's literally just Babylon. But the best advantage to go for is the military alliance Big Mac Strat. Before we talk about that, I'm just going to give a quick disclaimer. If you build a lot of ranged units and the AI doesn't, which is a lot of the time, you will have a good advantage, as if you put your ranged units on the back line, fortify your melee units on the front, and then use your ranged units to attack from the back line, you will win that war because ranged units don't take a damage back when they do attack. So obviously, if you build a mainly ranged unit army, you can go to war even if you are at a disadvantage, especially if you're on the defensive. But the best strategy is the military alliance Big Mac strat. Find your target, find the neighbor on the opposite side of your target. You're the bottom bun, he's the top bun. The target's the patty. We've explained this a million times. Sign a military alliance with the allied civ, and then do a joint of declaration of war against the target. Trust me when I say you will probably be able to walk through no problem, especially if you hang back 3 to 4 turns, as your ally will probably send in all their units, causing the target to move their forces away from your border to meet the ally, and after a while you can then walk in, and you'll have about 3 to 5 turns, which should be more than enough time to take out 2 to 3 good cities that will allow you to break your enemy's war efforts of the target AI, wipe out any reinforcing units now that you have the initiative, and then you can finish off the target you have with your ally. In essence, this strategy or tip is trying to find an advantage, any advantage that will help your units be a lot stronger than the AI, and if you don't have one, especially on higher difficulties, it's better to not go to war and work towards an advantage until you have one. Subscribe to not miss out on future content, and leave a like if you enjoyed the video. Check out my other videos for more Civ 6 tips, and I will see you all in the next video. Peace.